Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the stream. Once we start up the game, feel free to let me know if the audio is a bit off. I'm still trying to get everything together since I got my new recording software. Same recording software, but it's a different version. So feel free to let me know that. Also, it would really help if I made a shortcut for the Umineko folder. I still haven't moved that yet. That's going to take a second. There we go. Alright, one more thing. Alright. So, we last left off at New Portrait, where apparently Kienzo is going to tell us a story. I'm not really sure who this is. I kind of thought it was Kienzo all of a sudden. He does have very white hair. Oh well. Let's continue.
お前は金蔵なのか。昔のおじいさまです。写真で見たことがあります。これは一体ベルンカステルのくれた感激者の力だ。無理に理解するな。頭痛になら分かってきたな。
At one time, Genji told Battler that he looked like Kienzo in his youth. Sure enough, the young Kienzo wasn't exactly the same as Battler. They looked very similar. Didn't keep me in suspense for long. Yeah, the theater-going thing is pretty cheating, I would admit, but... I guess at this point in the story, we're probably gonna need some cheating.
後宮金蔵である。おじいさま。Even
the voice seemed to resemble Battler somehow. Clearly Battler had inherited Kienzo's blood more thickly than any other.
私は後宮家など継ぎたくはなかった。
You sure that's not Battler? With just white hair.
私が当主に選ばれたのは運命のいたずらに過ぎぬのだ。 関東大震災でおもだった者が死にたい。ブンケス寺のお前が抜擢された。そうです。おじいさまは若くとも聡明な方で、当主にふさわしい貫禄を若くしてお持ちの方でしたから。It's
probably why it's a power only approved by the Senate in Burn Castell.
とんでもない。欲深な長老たちは。 互いの利益ばかりを主張し合い、新しい当主を選び出すことさえできなかったのだ。まるで沈みゆく船で新しき船長は誰かと議論するような愚かさよ。だからこそ本家の誰とも縛らみのないお前が突然に抜擢を受けた。すべてはこの足の指のせいだ。 足の指が一本ずつ足りなかったなら、我が人生は全く異なるものになっていたであろう。
Oh, I was just thinking, like, what is he talking about? And I was like, oh yeah, I forgot he's got like six toes on each foot. In the Ushirimiya family, polydactyly was seen as a sign of good fortune. This was because many of the great ones in the family history hadn't had it.
くだらぬ話よ。長老どもは自分たちの誰も得をしない馬の骨であれば誰でもよかった。たまたま分家筋に両足の指が6本ある者がいると耳に入り、それでいいと決まったわけか。そういうことだ。長老どもは自分たちの操り人形になるなら次期当主など どこの青二歳でもよかったのだ。むしろ帝王学に無知な人間ほど好ましい。おじいさま。リオン、お前は違う。お前は我が全てを受け継ぐものだ。
That's a good question. How many toes does Battler have?
お前が生を受けた日より、それは運命づけられていた。
I feel like having six toes would make fitting shoes hard.
だからこそ、お前に銀の指輪を与え、厳しく育ててきた。
そなたは私とは違う。誰にも恥じることのない立派な当主跡継ぎであるぞ。はい。操り人形の当主か。気楽なものじゃねえだろうな。He's got three on each foot.
As he pondered about where to begin, Kinzo laughed bitterly. It would probably bring back painful memories no matter where he started from.
あれはあまりに長い長い。それは私には岩に蒸す苔のような気の遠くなるほど長い長い死んだ時間。
Not voice acting, however, people are far more resilient than one would think. Though I spent so many days as though I had been killed, I was not killed. So I was forced to search for my death on my own. Before I realized it, I reached an age at which the young would laugh at me if I tried to call myself young. That dizzyingly long stretch of gray was left completely empty. It lasted for a full 20 years. In 20 years, a person can be born, find a purpose, and even become their own man with their own place in the world. In short, if one truly becomes a human only when they have become a working adult, then I spent a time long enough to create a human. But by doing nothing except playing the part of those greedy elders' puppet. Ironically, though that time aged my body, it did not age my mind. My mind alone was still as young as it had been during those rich, happy days before I had been summoned to Odawara. And yet my body alone had grown older and older. Eventually, the vast gap between the two grew to almost incomprehensible levels. So I could hardly believe that the worn-out man in the mirror was really me. No, it really wasn't me. The head of the Ushirimiya family was just a name. It had no power. It didn't require that I have any independence. There was no need for me to get involved with anything. I was just a doll sitting there in the doll rack, gathering dust. I remember nothing but lazily flipping through Western books I liked, locking myself in my own world, doing nothing but playing with roses and drinking terrible drinks. And it lasted a full 20 years. Before I knew it, I suddenly had a wife I didn't know. It wasn't any wife I had chosen. It was the daughter of some noble family that the elders had chosen and forced on me for their own reasons. But that did not matter to me. I did not love my wife, but neither did I dislike her. I just didn't care. I fathered a few children, but that wasn't out of love for my wife. They were just born before I knew it. That's all there was to it. None of it mattered. No, that's not quite right. Everything was decided by someone other than me, and I simply obeyed. That was the job of the Ushirimiya family head.
Ah, このまま自分は 静かに殺されるなど。
信じられません。強胆なるメイ君と称えられたおじい様が。
そのような日々を送っていたなんて。リオンよ、自ら生きぬ人生ほど気迫で長いものはない。 なのに、それはあっという間に過ぎ去るのだ。心せよ。
自ら生きる人生。
生きるってことは意志を持つということだ。殺された日々だったろうよ。
そうだ、私は生きたかった。いや、死にたかった。操り人形はどうすれば死ねる。
糸を断ち切ることです。
そうだ、それが死ぬことであり生きることであり解放だ。
Before I realized it, the world had grown troubled. World War II. The Pacific War. Japan had extended their war fronts too far to the east and west, and the tide of war was changing. Thanks to the influence of the elders, I was able to avoid conscription. Of course, this was not out of compassion for me. It was because I was their precious puppet. So the war never really felt that close to me. However, when I personally decided to abandon their protection, it was very easy. At the time, the Ushirimiya family had almost completely collapsed. And since the elders had apparently gathered enough of the scraps to last them the rest of their lives, they seemed to care little for what I did, now that they no longer had any use for me. So, I realized I had finally found my time to die. One by one, I cut the threads I was hanging from, and began to search for a place to end my life.
戦地で死を求めようとしたのか。
同じ死ぬなら、誰かの役に立つべきと思った。いや、違う。私には自らの命を絶つ気力さえなかったのだろう。もっともらしく死ねる理由が戦争だったのだ。
おじい様は土木建築の知識がありましたので、海軍設営隊にて施設造成などに従事されたと聞いています。
とんだ誤算よ。何の取り柄もないと言っておけばすぐにも死ねる最前線へ送られたものを。
最前線に行かずに済んだのか。
幸いと喜ぶ仲間もいたよ。私には逆だった。戦って死ぬという出来過ぎた美酒の焼け酒が欲しかっただけなのだ。忘れられた島の上空を米軍の編隊は横切っていくだけ。彼らは私のために爆弾一つどころか鉛玉の一つさえ恵んではくれなかったのだよ。
おじい様はその日々の中でベアトリーチェにお会いになられたのですか。
そうだ、あれは海からやってきた。
どこで会った。島と言ったが。
ここだよ、この島にやってきたのだ。
お前たちは六軒島で出会っていたというのか。
どういうことですか。おじい様が六軒島を買い取るまでは無人島だったと聞いています。この島に日本軍の基地があったなどとは初耳です。
そうだな、あんなものは基地とは呼ばぬ。ただの岩窟よ。私はその岩窟の番人だったのだ。
1944. Due to the honorable defeats at the Saipan and Guam, Japan's absolute national defense zone strategy was in shambles. Where had the gallantry shown at Pearl Harbor gone? The old attackers were now the ones in the defensive. At that time, it was said that the last trump card for the Japanese military was a type of manned torpedo known as the Kaiten. It was said that these ultimate weapons were packed with 1.55 tons of explosives, and capable of sinking any kind of warship with a single blast. To strengthen homeland defense, the Navy drafted a plan to build a string of hidden bases from Hachijo Island to Yokosuka, all to house submarines loaded with Kaiten torpedoes.
八丈島に基地が作られたことは知っていました。しかし、それが六軒島にもあったなんて。どこの間抜けがこんな何もない島に作ろうと言い出したやら。人苦情の都合。バカバカしい。お上の考えることなどわからぬし、私にとってもどうでもいいことだった。
The Kaiten, which could finish off a large warship with a single strike, truly was an ultimate weapon. It was hoped that the presence of submarines capable of loading these weapons in the waters just off of Japan would allow for a powerful sea ambush as a final line of defense. So, to aid in the establishment of a base with absolute secrecy, the uninhabited island Rokenjima was raised as a possible candidate. An investigation of the island resulted in the discovery of a large cave in the cliffs, and this was apparently deemed to be a suitable location for a submarine base.
お前はその基地の建設に関わったわけか。建設?岩窟を掘り広げただけを建設と呼ぶならな。しかもその上、 基地は未完成のまま放置されたのだから。どうしてです? <笑>当時の日本にそいつを詰めるほどの大型潜水艦はもう残っていなかったのよ。滑稽な話だ。潜水艦もないのに潜水艦基地など今更必要なものか。役人の無意味な箱物作りは
今も昔も変わらぬわ。The base on Hachijo Island was outfitted with Kaiten torpedoes and became a base for direct attacks. But Rokenjima was never supplied with any. Really? It's like making nukes but not having anything that can shoot it. True that. Furthermore, the construction was eventually suspended, and the minimum number of men were stationed on the island, waiting for orders from above that never came. Could it be the fact that it was a hidden base sealed our fate? The higher-ups had already completely forgotten about this useless and pointless cavern. We were nothing more than guards for a mere cave. We spent our days farming, fishing, playing with the dirt, all the while gazing up at the American formations flying past. Some of our group were relieved at the prospects of the war ending, before anyone remembered we were here, and before any of us had to face a real battle. Of course, it was the opposite for me. I hoped and hoped for the American troops to advance and kill me as soon as possible. Those days were empty and blank. Let us go back. Back to the turning point in my life and my fate. The time that Ushirimiya Kinzo finally became alive. I like it. It's like a history lesson where Kinzo tries to kill himself.
Kisama tarundeiruzo!
What do you want us to do? Throw submarine torpedoes at the air flames? Stars seemed to spin around inside my head. I could just lie down on the floor, but that'd only make him more angry. I've no intention of being obedient. Still, it'd be stupid to get myself punched for no reason. So I stood up and stood at attention. The fighting's close, is it? You really think the American troops are likely to show up on this forgotten island? Then let them come right now. That's what I've been waiting for all this time.
その腐った目つきは何か?貴様、そんなに死にたくないか?そんなに米兵が恐ろしいか?そんな気合では撃ち取れんぞ!
I was hit again. Could you please quit your whining already? Filthy cowards. They let themselves be controlled by this inexplicable anger because it was the only way to distract themselves from their own fear. Heart and spirit aren't any use when the battle becomes hopeless. When trapped by an insurmountable hopelessness, humans will rely on several other emotions to escape their fear. For these young, inexperienced soldiers, anger was a very convenient emotion to fall back upon. Anger is the wine they used to paralyze their fear. It made them chant, the British, the Americans, as they swung their bamboo spears around and call it drilling. The more one drinks wine, the more they need to drink to get drunk. Their useless anger continued to pile up, day after day, without pause. I did not fear death, so I had no need of the wine called anger. This made their cowardice all the more apparent to me.
その目つきだ。後ろ見や。貴様の魂は腐りきっておるわ。魚だ。貴様の目は死んだ魚の目だ。
You fish?However, it went both ways. Just as I was able to spot their cowardice, they were able to pick up on my lethargy. I wonder if it's just a placeholder image, or if I'm supposed to recognize that this looks familiar. I'm thinking it's more just a placeholder image, but you never know. First Lieutenant Yamamoto was the commanding officer in charge of the Rokenjima garrison. He was just another filthy coward trying to forget his fear with violence, and would often reprimand his subordinates for slacking off at the drop of a hat. The stories of his life he'd spout off when in a good mood were all about how much of a thug he had been, ignoring the rules of society. On and on about how so-and-so was a prick, so he taught them a lesson, how everyone was so scared of him that he got special treatment. He kept on talking about what a vile human he was as though it was a badge of honor. Normally I had nothing to do with this disagreeable lieutenant. He would always hang around with his non-commissioned subordinates. So as long as I treated him with a snappy salute, I could more or less ignore him for the time being. Yeah, it seems familiar. I'm not entirely sure if that's supposed to be because the areas that we've seen under Rokenjima Island before are these exact same areas that were built by these troops, or if it's entirely just incidental and they just needed a background image and it was far easier to use one that we'd used before. I don't know. I think both of those could have the equal possibility being true. Now that the construction project on this island has been suspended indefinitely, there's no longer any use for an engineer like me. So why did the lieutenant ask for me specifically? At that moment, I couldn't think of anything.
後ろ見や。貴様は外国語が堪能であると聞いたが事実であるか?
英語と中国語を話せるであります。中尉殿。
The lieutenant liked to brag about his education in front of the non-commissioned officers. But he held a bit of a grudge against me for being even more highly educated than him, since he also felt uncomfortable about having a subordinate who was older than him. I wasn't exactly a person he would be willing to confide in. Just the fact that I knew several languages must have hurt his pride.
ならばイタリア語はどうか？
わかりません。
では貴様にイタリア人との通訳は務まらんというわけか。
I would say that's probably true.
英語を喋れる者がいれば可能と思います。
なるほど、確かに。貴様、外国人と英語で話した経験はあるのか？
あります。
Why on earth would he need an interpreter in a cave on an uninhabited island that even our superiors have forgotten? His question made it clear that some guest had arrived on Rokinjima who would need an interpreter.
よし、後ろ宮、貴様を俺の通訳に命ず。
That evening, I found out exactly what he was talking about. You know, I was also thinking, if you look back at a lot of those pictures, they look very industrial, all the ones that we've seen of that underground area before. Which would kind of make sense if a military installation set it up. That pointless cavern submarine dock that had never been used was now being approached slowly by a submarine of the Italian Navy. Of course I knew that the Italians had been our allies. However, this was the first time I had seen anything from their military with my own eyes.
どうしてイタリア軍が?
Leon, what are you doing in my story? Get out of here.
1943年にイタリアは降伏しているはずです。これはどういうことでしょう?
降伏したのはイタリア王国だ。だが、それを受け入れない者たちは、新独政権 RSI を樹立させ、戦争を続けたのだ。
RSI
イタリア社会共和国別名サロ共和国
詳しい何も知らぬ者はイタリアは枢軸国の中で1943年にいち早く降伏した腰抜けなどと呼んでいるがそれは間違いだイタリア社会共和国軍は開戦から1945年4月29日まで勇敢に戦ったのだ
ベルリン降伏はその3日後だ腰抜けどころか大健闘だ
I hear a lot of percussion in my right ear
しかし RSI 海軍が日本まで航行できるような潜水艦を持っていたとは驚きだ
そうでなくともはるばる日本までやってきたこと自体が驚きです彼らはなぜ日本に六軒島に
The submarine was both weather-worn and massive I doubt anyone had imagined that a foreign submarine would come all the way hereWhen we'd never even had one of our own submarines dock here. All of the guards of Rokinjima, of which there were only about 30, stood at attention as the submarine docked.
イタリア軍は初めて見たぞ。
なんでも事故か食雷で航行不能になったんだと。
換気装置がやられて、塩素ガスが換気できなくなったって聞いたぞ。
注意どもの話によると、何か重要なものを運んでるって話だ。
暗号変換機か新型エンジンなんかの設計図じゃないの
か俺は爪にうんぬんより上層部がまだここを覚えててくれたことの方が驚きだぜ
後ろ宮早く来い貴様は通訳だろうが
はい注意だろ
On top of the hatch was a young Italian saluting us Normally this should have been a job of a commissioned officer But his clothes looked like those of a sailorAnd it really didn't look like he had the dignity and composure of a ship's captain. That probably meant that all of the commissioned officers in charge had died in the accident that had befallen the sub. crew members crawled out of the hatch one by one, but they all looked entirely pale and entirely worn out. I'm not sure how long ago the accident happened, but being crammed together in a tiny sub filled with chlorine gas for any amount of time can't be good for your health. Not only are the ventilators broken, but traveling about carelessly on the surface of the waters around Japan these days would be foolish in the extreme. Their trip had been like one inside a can of poison gas. Almost all of them were unable to walk without leaning on someone else. It looked like a bunch of people staggering out of a hospital boat.
Ushiromiya, 艦長は誰か聞け。 私がこの島の指揮官であることを説明せよ。
Are we gonna get some lovely English here?
ようこそ、日本へ。 英語がわかるもの。
Crew members seemed to understand that I was speaking English, but it looked as though none of them could speak it. Eventually, someone who seemed to be dressed as an officer saluted.
ようこそ、日本へ。 艦長でありますか?
I can not speak English.
Yes, there we go.
Please, wait.
The officer answered in slow, laborious English. We got a little bit. After asking us to wait, he shouted something to his subordinates in a rapid Italian. It looked as though he was telling them to get someone among them who could speak English.
Ushiromiya, 何と言っている?
待てと言っています。 英語のわかる人間を...
Yeah, what a nice Italian accent. At that moment, I heard a high-pitched cough. It wasn't a man's cough. It was a woman's. Oh, a woman? You do, because that doesn't sound like English at all. She came down from the hatch. A woman with beautiful golden hair said this in English. In Japanese. In this filthy cavern, the appearance of one as beautiful as she was seemed like an angel descending upon us.
ようこそ、日本へ。
ビアトリーチ。
艦長はいますか?
艦長は死んだわ。 士官はあそこの彼だけよ。
お悔やみ申し上げます。 何かお手伝いはできますか?
新鮮な空気と水が欲しいわ。まだ息のある人間もいる。休ませる場所が欲しいわ。協力しましょう。他に英語のわかる人間はいますか? いたけどみんな死んだわ。
Well, that's grim.
私だけよ。後ろ見よ!
Beatrice and Madeline in casual clothes.
艦長は誰だ? さっきの男なのか? その女は何者なのか? 早く通訳しろ!
The lieutenant has been yelling like that for a while now. He must have been surprised to see such a beautiful woman appear from the submarine. And more than a little annoyed to see all of her attention focused on me alone. It was a mark of how divinely beautiful she was.
注意殿。 彼女だけが英語をわかるようです。彼女が彼らの通訳になります。艦長は死亡。代表者は先ほどの士官のようです。あのうるさくあなたに叫んでいる男は何者?まさかあなたの上司なの?不幸なことに、私が美しいお嬢さんを独り占めしているのが気に入らないんでしょう。
東洋人にお世辞をもらえるとは思わなかったわ。綺麗な英語ね。あなたは育ちが良さそうだわ。あの怒鳴ってるみっともない男とは大違い。あなたがここの将校だったらよかったのに。おや、私も西洋人にお世辞をもらえるとは思いませんでした。<笑>あなたは面白い人だわ。名前は?
Kinzo is so smooth.
Ushiromiya Kinzo desu. Yoroshikereba, ojousan no namae mo zehi.
Beatrice Castiglione.
Yōkoso, Beatrice. Nihon e.
That was when I first met Beatrice, the woman who would capture my heart for the rest of my life. Extra desire added.
Beatrice とはイタリア人だったのですか？
そうだ。彼女は RSI 交換の娘だった。どうやら彼女の父親こそが一番の積み荷だったらしい。残念ながら、ロッケン島にたどり着いた時にはもう死んでいた。
その交換がなぜ日本に？スエズ運河からインド洋を越えて、はるばる日本まで来たというのか。
確かに、同盟国としてはドイツの方がはるかに近いはず。なぜわざわざ日本までやってきたのでしょう。
途方もない規模の遠大な作戦か何かだったのかもしれぬ。その全容はわからぬ。その潜水艦がただならぬ任務を帯びていたらしいことは後に理解することとなる。
They said that there had been about 60 of them at the time of their departure. However, only about 10 of them, including Beatrice, had survived. Their submarine had apparently hit a mine or something in the nearby waters and sustained a great deal of damage. They told us that it had flooded rapidly with water, which had taken out the batteries and released a large amount of chlorine gas. Their sub had become completely incapable of continuing further. Nothing but a massive lump of metal floating by the dock. Since the sub seemed to be carrying something of immense value, the higher-ups ordered us to investigate. After questioning the Italians, with Beatrice and me acting as double interpreters, we concluded that this thing of immense value must have been her father himself. Apparently, Beatrice's father was extremely high up in the RSI hierarchy, and it was thought that he might have worked alongside Mussolini himself. Though their massive voyage had apparently been a part of some top-secret mission, now that the man himself and all of his commissioned officers had died, their reason for coming to Japan remained a mystery. And since the higher-ups were telling us to investigate, that meant that even they didn't know what it was. Their ship had broken down, their mission was unknown, and the high official they had been carrying was dead. And even the Japanese government didn't know why they were here. The Italians' great and perilous journey had come to a meaningless and utterly fruitless end.
よかった。日本の潮風はてっきり醤油の匂いがすると思ってたわ。
お互い様です。イタリア人の髪はパスタでできてるって思ってました。
あら、そうよ。アルデンテに仕上げるには茹で加減が難しいの。なら日本人はみんなスパゲティネーロだわ。
よくご存知で。日本人はシャンプーの代わりにイカスミを使います。
I'm very sad that this isn't all translated English. What an adventure that would be. And also probably really difficult, but still.
金蔵はすごいわ。何でも知っているのね。イタリアに来たことがあるの？
ありません。しかし本はいろいろと読みました。
東洋人がイタリアの本を？へえ。例えばどんな？
ニッコロ・マキャベッリ、ダンテ・アリギエリ。だからあなたが永遠の宿女であることも存じていますよ。
おお、なんてこと。金蔵はとんでもない勉強家だわ。あなたはひょっとして日本では高貴な家の出身なのでは？
さあ。
あなたは他の野蛮そうな日本人とはまるで違うわ。私にはわかるの。あなたはきっと高貴な家の人間だわ。後宮家は日本の貴族の家柄なの？
とんでもない。宝石で一山当てただけの ただの成金の一族です。私が勉強していたのは高貴なる者としてのたしなみではなく、何をすることも許されなかったら本を読むか酒に溺れるかしかやることがなかったからですよ。
There had been no trace of malice in Beatrice's words. It had just been a curious question asked to a friend from a faraway country. However, Beatrice was from a noble family herself, so she could tell. She could see the faint, gloomy look on Kinzo's face.
許して、キンゾー。あなたのような高貴な人がどうしてこんなおかしなところで兵卒の身分に甘んじているのか深く考えなかったわ。
私の一族などどうでもいいことです。死ねば後ろ宮などという姓は何の意味もない。そしてそれこそがようやく私を。
金蔵は死にたくて軍隊に？そんなのダメ。家族が悲しむわ。
家族だと私には誰も。
I have a wife for the sake of public appearances and children. However, I've never wanted any of them. Everything is a fleeting daydream created by their selfish, greedy elders. So, at least being stuck on this island, I can forget about all of that and find some peace. Peace?But haven't I spent each and every day complaining that I wasn't sent to the front and haven't managed to die yet?
私にあなたの苦しみはわからないけれど、私の心ない言葉が傷つけてしまったことはわかるわ。許して、金蔵。
And I was starting to think just now, because the story is that, you know, Beatrice granted him like a whole ton of gold.So now we see this Beatrice. I wonder if her being kind of a high up family or high up person, or at least the daughter of a high up person, would make it so that her family has a lot of money. Maybe that's where that comes from. I don't know. Forgive me, Kinzo. Yes, those words are probably what did it. All of the Japanese people called me Ushirimiya.It reminded me that I was the property of the Ushirimiya family every time they talked to me. But she was different. She called me Kinzo, not Ushirimiya. So maybe just for the time I chat with her like this, I can forget that cursed family.
Kinzo.
I hadn't meant to make Beatrice feel guilty.But she seemed certain that her thoughtless words had hurt me.
ありがとう。
え？
あなたが私を金蔵と呼んでくれるから、私はやっと自分を取り戻すことができる。私はようやく本当の意味で私を見てくれる人に出会えた気がします。
金蔵、あなたはとても遠い異国で出会った外国人だけれど、あなたの心はとても繊細で美しい。私たちはきっと近所に住んでいたならとても当たり前な友人になっていたわ。私も嬉しいのよ。あなたは私のことをベアトリーチェと呼ぶ。カスティリオーニの御礼状とは呼ばないわ。
That's probably because that takes a lot longer to say. As you just demonstrated, we were both in the same position. Her... Oh god, I don't know if I even want to give that a shot. Castiglioni? Family must have been a rigid place as well.Though we came from different countries, we had finally found something we both understood.
Kinzo は親しい者には何て名前で？
いえ、
Idiot.
普通に金蔵と呼ばれていました。
じゃあ、あなたは私をベアトリーチェと呼ぶのを改めるべきだわ。親しい人間は私のことをビーチェと呼んでいた。あなたもそうしてくれると嬉しいわ。
ビース？
わかりました。
I don't know about that. That's a weird name.
これからは親しみを込めてビーチェとお呼びを。
ダメダメ。堅苦しい言葉はダメ。だって私たちはもう友人なのだから。
I don't know about that name. Sounds slightly derogatory. A bright smile stretched across Beatrice's face.
あの美少女、あれから何十年を経ようとも、我が記憶より薄れることはない。
おじい様はベアトリーチェと出会うことで自分を取り戻されたのですね。
平たく言いや浮気だな。
ウィルさんは今後も失言を繰り返されるならお尻をかばわれる癖をつけることをお勧めします。
After having his butt pinched once more, Will hopped around in pathetic agony.
おじい様にとってロッケン島はベアトリーチェと初めて出会われた特別な場所だったのですね。
私がこの島に来ることがなければ出会うこともなかった奇跡の島なのだ。
その潜水艦基地の名残とやらは今も
クアドリアンの近くに今も残っている。外界からは見えぬ入り江の影だ。不吉がって漁師たちも近寄らなかった島だ。私以外に知る者はもはやいるまい。
クワドリアンと屋敷を結ぶ2キロにも及ぶ地下道はその基地の名残なのか。
そうだ。
Yep, okay, so all of that underground was the old base.So, in fact, them being in, I think it was, what was that, episode 4, 5? I don't know. Them being all locked up inside of that, like, cage thing, maybe they were, like, locked up in, like, the military's brig or something. I don't know. That'd be kind of cool. I mean, I'm sure that's not far from the truth, if not that exactly.
鍾乳洞を改造した広大な地下壕で地下を網羅し。
Episode 4? Okay.
島内各地を要塞化するなどという寝言の残骸だ。私はその地下道を生かし島の両端に2つの屋敷を作らせたのだ。
2つの屋敷、2つの家族、後宮家の屋敷と後宮家から解放された金蔵の屋敷だったのですね。
そうだ。私には必要だったのだ。後宮という呪われた姓から逃れるもう一つの場所が。
Yeah, they did end up getting out of a well. I wonder why it connects via a well. The well was probably to hide it, I would imagine.
しかし、同情するよ。はるばる日本までやってきて任務を成し遂げられなかったとは気の毒の限りだ。
パパの任務が何だったかよくわからないわ。どこか遠くへ逃げ、大切な日までそれを隠さなければならないと言っていた。
それとは？
わからないわ。それはとても大切なもので、大切な日まで何年も隠しているつもりだったみたい。いえ、それと一緒に隠れているつもりだったみたい。私に 異国の地で長い時間を過ごすことになるかもしれないと謝っていたから。
アンジェロ少尉は罪には特になく。
Not that.
君の父上が輸送すべき要人だったと言っていたが。
少尉はあなたたちを信用してないわ。私でさえ知っていることをいくつも隠してる。ひょっとすると少尉はパパの目的と罪人を知っているのかも。
それが何だったにせよ、それはイタリア軍の任務さ。俺らには関係ないね。むしろ同盟国なんだ。頼ってくれればいいのに。
金蔵が良い人であることは疑わないわ。少尉にもあなたは信頼できる人間だと伝えてるんだけれど、どうして男というのは異教ではむやみやたらと厳格になるの？普段はみんなもっと陽気な人たちばかりなのに、ここへ来てからみんな妙に空気が張り詰めているわ。少尉は部下たち全員に常時銃を手放さないように命じてる。まるでここが敵地かのようだわ。
That was true. The Italians were clearly the very opposite of relaxed. The Japanese soldiers watching this began to suspect that the Italians didn't really trust them at all.
軍人ならおかしいことじゃないさ。むしろこういう時こそ規律を引き締めて友軍に恥ずかしいところを見せたくないんじゃないか。
就寝時には必ず寝ず番を立てるし、もう航行できないスクラップ同然の潜水艦に今もあなたたちを近づけないように見張りを立てているわ。私はなんだか日本人を露骨に毛嫌いしているように見えて気持ちが悪い。
True, they had set up a constant sentry by the submarine and had refused to let any of the Japanese soldiers come near. This hadn't made the Japanese particularly happy. However, submarines are treated as classified in all countries. Racism, yeah, sure. Maybe it was just natural for them to stop foreigners from approaching it without reason.
慣れない生活を強いられて、みんな気が立ってるんだろう。天候とお上の都合で、君たちを本土へ運ぶ船の派遣がまた遅れてる。君たちをいつ本土へ送ってあげられるやら。
We had been told that a boat was being sent for them directly from the mainland. But apparently, thanks to the weather, problems up the command chain and the recent air raids, there were no ships to spare for a forgotten island like this. They might have been some sort of diplomatic problem. After all, their homeland had already surrendered to the Allies. I didn't know the details. The only thing I knew for sure was that they'd been stuck in Rokenjima for 2 whole weeks, and no one had come to get them. Commander Chan? Of course, we had some small boats in Rokenjima. There was nothing physically stopping us from taking them to a nearby island. Still, Rokenjima was technically a top secret base, and contact with the outside world had been strictly forbidden.
仕方がないし、それも悪くないわ。だって、船が来てしまったら、金蔵とはもう会えなくなってしまうんでしょ？
ああ、確かに。
To me, those 2 weeks were the first I'd ever truly lived. The faint 20 years before all seemed to vanish in the sparkle of those 2 weeks. I realized that she would have to leave this place eventually. And yet, this one moment felt so rich and dazzling that I felt myself wishing it could last forever. Then I heard a voice calling for Beatrice in Italian.
Angelo 少尉だよ。君に用事みたいだ。
またおこごとかしら。 日本人とあまり親しくするなと最近うるさいのよ。
The ensign approached, saluting Kinzo. And after glancing at Beatrice as though asking her to translate something, he began to speak in Italian. Judging by his tone, it sounded like something serious.
少尉はとても重要な話があるからあなたたちの指揮官に会わせてほしいと言ってるわ。協力を求めたいと言っている。何のことかわからないわ。
重要な話？わかった。山本中尉を探そう。
Ensign Angelo had two of his subordinates with him and wore a stern expression on his face. They didn't have to say anything for us to realize that this must be something very serious.
いいぞ！上げろ！
The winch creaked and the thick chains rang out with a dull clang. Very, very slowly, it was lifted up out of the submarine's cargo hold.
なるほど。イタリア人どもが我々を潜水艦に近づけたがらないわけだ。
The lieutenant and the others looked up at what the winch was slowly lifting up. All of them wearing unpleasant, forced smiles.
なんてこと。
It was another submarine.
これが
in the submarine.
パパの運んでいた積み荷だというの。
すごい。こんなの生まれて初めて見た。
Oh. Maybe that's where my gold answer comes from. It was a mountain of gold ingots. Those carefully piled bars were being slowly lifted out of the cargo hold, one group after another. This gold had been their true cargo. Yep, there's my gold.I don't know where they were planning to take it. They might have been trying to sneak it into Japan, one of their allies. Or they might have been on their way to hide it in some remote area. Was it some sort of strategy? A conspiracy? A conspiracy? Embezzlement? Top secret transportation of wealth? This incomprehensible amount of gold led to all sorts of dark suspicions. But we didn't know anything about the truth.All told, the gold weighed an incredible 10 tons. That was the only truth we could wrap our minds around at the moment. They had strongly resisted showing this to us. However, the submarine could no longer make sea, and it was apparently continuing to take in water bit by bit. It might be because there's so much stupid gold inside of it.Rokenjima had been outfitted in an extremely slipshod way, so we had no means of repairing it. Also, while we could unload the sub, there's no way we could lift it up again once it had filled with water and sunk to the bottom. Now that it was clear that transporting the gold had become completely impossible, they had apparently decided on unloading it. Of course, they made no effort to explain the reason for all this gold.They just asked us to help them take it out.
なぜこんな大量の黄金を国外へ?
Fashionably late to the stream, I see.
これだけあればイタリアの戦局を変えられたかもしれないのに。
戦局を変えるのは武器よ。でも戦後は何の役にも立たないわ。
Your theory is they were going to smuggle it to South America?Where all the World War II criminals ran to? Sorry, give me just like 10 seconds here. Sorry, I had something caught in my throat there.
確かに、お金も戦局を変えはするでしょうよ。でも、戦後にもその価値は変わらない。
How do you do, my fellow theater goers?There's no longer any way to change the course of this war. The Axis powers would probably all surrender, leading to an Allied victory. anyone could tell this simply by looking at the American planes flying across the sky day after day. However, gold does not lose its value after war. Everyone stared upwards, dumbfounded, as the wind slowly lifted the dully sparkling gold. I can only imagine this is going to lead to some kind of conflict. If nothing else, you could at least take a big piece of gold and whack someone in the face and kill them. That's heavy. Put it in a bag and then you can swing it at him. Oh man, that'll hurt.
注意。イタリア人たちはこの黄金のことを本土へ報告しないことを望んでいます。
我が国に横領されたくないからであろうな。
彼は何と？
日本が黄金を横領するのを恐れているから、報告されたくないのだろうと言っている。
少尉はむしろイタリア本国に知られることを恐れているわ。
You guys steal it? Rob a bank?
私たちにとって、今の祖国は連合国の傀儡政権。彼らに知られれば、黄金は返還することになる。
Yeah, that's what I was referencing, was Rosa using it as a weapon. That's all they gotta do here.
しかしそれは、私たちの敵に黄金を渡すようなもの。
They had come all this way to make sure that the gold didn't fall into enemy hands. They needed to hide this gold from the puppet government until their homeland could be truly restored.
後ろ宮、イタリア人たちに提案せよ。我々は協力を申し出たいとな。
協力とは？
イタリア人たちの言い分はこうであろう。彼らはその黄金を祖国に知られることなく隠したいわけだ。しかし、この島から運び出そうとすれば、輸送船を手配せねばならなくなる。そうすれば本土に知られ、さらにはイタリア本国にも知られることとなる。
そうなります。つまり、あの黄金はもう六軒島からは運び出せない。
Their mission must have been to hide that gold in absolute secrecy until the day of their homeland's restoration. Later on, several plausible rumors would circulate about how Nazi Germany also moved much of its secret wealth to certain hidden areas in South America just prior to its collapse. It was a very natural conclusion to reach. That submarine was their only method of transporting the gold in secrecy, and it's become completely useless. They can't fully stop the water from seeping in, and it'll probably sink completely before much longer. There's no longer any way for them to transport the gold in secrecy. In other words, their mission has ended in failure here in the Far East. So, just how is Lieutenant Yamamoto proposing that we assist them? He probably wants a cut of it, I'm sure. What do I think of Episode 7 so far? I'm liking it. It's a lot slower, definitely not focused anywhere nearly as much on the events of the game. It's actually focused pretty much nothing on the game. And it's focused more on this weird Leon character that we don't know, and Kinzo's backstory, and Beatrice's backstory too, I suppose, which is pretty interesting.
この六軒島基地は誰も知らぬ秘密基地だ。近隣の島民たちはこの島を不吉な無人島と信じて近寄りもしない。言っている意味がわかるか、後ろ宮。
彼は何と？
前にも話した通り、この六軒島基地は誰にも知られていない。見ての通り、戦略価値は何もなく、上層部にもすでに忘れられてる。注意はこの島に黄金を隠してはどうかと提案したいみたいだ。
It's not a bad strategy, which is probably what's gonna happen. Beatrice quickly translated this and told Ensign Angelo. The Ensign began discussing rapidly with his subordinates. They didn't look happy. All right, you guys come up with a better idea. Maybe make a submarine out of gold. That might work. Japan may have been their ally, but they probably didn't want the gold for reconstructing their motherland to be entrusted to Asians. Still, it's hard to imagine any other option for them.
激しく議論しているわ。他に手はないというものもいるし、それでも祖国に忠誠を尽くすべきだというものもいる。少尉は板挟みになってるわ。
The final order given to them by their fallen homeland was to hide the gold. However, by now, there was no way for that order to be carried out successfully.I imagine good old-fashioned racism is playing a big role here. Probably. You know, I know it was true for Japan. I'm imagining it's probably true for quite a couple places. Everywhere, they were very xenophobic. If the mainland or their own homeland found out, the gold would probably be confiscated by the wrong people, from their point of view.If they really wanted to carry out their homeland's orders faithfully, Lieutenant Yamamoto's proposal was extremely reasonable. Though the lieutenant couldn't understand their words, it seemed he realized how divided they were.
我々が協力すれば、あの黄金を厳重に隠すことができるぞ。幸いなことに、廃棄された地下壕が長々とこの島の地下を横断している。
この島の地下に黄金を隠して埋めれば誰にも発見できないと言ってる。
現実的な申し出だと議論してるわ。でも日本人の手を借りるのに抵抗を感じてるみたい。
議論が難航しているようです。
議論の余地などあるのか、イタリア人。我々の協力なくば、あの黄金は隠せんぞ。まさかいつまでも波打ち際に積み上げておくわけにもいくまい。
アンジェロ少尉は、黄金のことを知る人間を最小で抑えたいみたい。日本人は信用できないけど、山本中尉の申し出が、今は最善と見てるみたいよ。でも、いぶかしがってるわ。
何を？
10トンの黄金を隠すという労力の提供と守秘義務を彼らが本当に無償で提供してくれるのかとね。
五分と五分だ。
注意、
yep.
それはまさか。
I was waiting for that. I knew that was gonna happen.
あの黄金の半分を我々によこせ。それを手間賃に、残りの半分を厳重に隠してやる。
I think with the value of that gold, that's a pretty hefty, like, percentage. The instant Beatrice translated that sentence, Ensign Angelo slammed his hand on the desk and stood up. Instead of flinching, Lieutenant Yamamoto, true to his boast of once being a thug that everyone feared,actually looked even more relaxed and confident than he had previously.
本来なら断りようのない話だ。8割を要求してもおかしくない。それを敬意を表して五分と五分にしようと提案しているのだ。これは我々だけに優位な話ではない。イタリア人たちが外部にこのことを漏らせば、すべての黄金は日本かイタリアに接収されるだ。我々には一円たりとも転がり込んでこない。我々は全員が共犯でなくてはならない。
全員に着服の共犯になれと言ってる。注意はすでに軍人としてでなく個人として話をしている。
なんてこと。黄金に目がくらんだのね。
Lieutenant Yamamoto was grinning. It really did look as though he'd been blinded by greed. Just as Beatrice said.
あのまま山積みにしていれば、 やがて本土から来る迎えの連中の目に嫌おうなく入るだろう。そうなればここにいる誰もが得をしない。
Put a big tarp over it. No one will notice.
我々の申し出を受けて早急に黄金を隠すべき。
アンジェロ少尉は日本政府やイタリア政府にはどうしても知られたくないみたい。彼は自分が与えられた任務に最後まで責任を持ちたいみたいよ。
つまりどういうことだ。
何割かを口止め料として与えてでも島内に地中深く埋めることを望んでるわ。もちろん下士官たちには異論もあるみたい。5割は問題外だと憤慨してるわ。
後ろ見よ、イタリア人たちの感触はどうだ。
彼らも黄金がこれ以上の人目につくことを望んでいないようです。しかし取り分に異論があるようです。
少尉は1割ならば検討できると言ってるわ。
See to me? That seems like pretty fair. 10% is like pretty fair. Yeah, 10% seems pretty fair. Like, that's an entire ton of gold. That is a lot of money. It really is. From something that you pretty much haven't done anything to earn.
もろん、山本中尉がそれで納得しないだろうとも言ってるけど。
後ろ宮、イタリア人の返事はいかに？
1割が検討すると。
This time...It was Lieutenant Yamamoto who slammed down on the desk. But the Italians didn't flinch either. An incredible tension filled the small room. However, despite his violent outburst a second ago, Lieutenant Yamamoto's expression still looked smug and in control. He was probably confident that he now had the initiative.
1割?1割か。いいだろう。なら1割を譲ってやろう。渋ろくだ。これ以上は譲らんと伝えろ。
40% for the Japanese. 60% for the Italians. The lieutenant made it sound like he was willing to stand firm on that. But in truth,These negotiations were not being made on equal footing. If the Italians just wanted the gold for themselves, there wouldn't have been much of a problem. But what if? What if they were really true patriots and decided that they would return the gold, even to the defeated puppet government of their homeland, for the purpose of reconstruction?Amount of gold according to George in 1986 is 10% of all the gold humanity had mined up until that point. I'm just saying, getting even 1% of all that gold is a massive amount of gold, even split among all these people. Just saying. If so, they would probably report the existence of the gold to the Italian embassy.Eventually, the Italian government would petition the Allied nations for the retrieval of their gold. It probably wouldn't all make it back to Italy, but it might be used to effectively repair and rebuild the battered towns. If that happened, Lieutenant Yamamoto and his friends would only be able to sneak out a few ingots at most. He was greedily planning to make his own treasure island.So that he and his subordinates could have an enormous fortune all to themselves. If he wanted those ambitions to bear out, the Italians would have to conceal the presence of the gold. I know greed's a big part of it. It's just the amount of gold, even 10%, is such a sheer amount. It's like, it's unfathomable, really.At least for me, I should say.
しかし疑問だ。アンジェロ少尉が誰にも黄金を渡したくないなら、 沈みゆく潜水艦に任せて沈めればよかったはず。
It's enough to kill for. Yeah, I am possibly expecting some kind of battle happening here with the outnumbered Italians possibly going down. It could still happen.
どうして荷揚げを？
考えたくはないけれど、命令が遂行不能になった時点で、少尉はこの黄金を横領することを考え始めたのかも。彼は今、下士官たちに軍人としての意見と、祖国に家族が待つ一個人としての意見を聞きたいと言っているわ。堅物の下士官たちが激高してる。
The discussion between the Italians was becoming fierce and emotional. Though their homeland had fallen, they had come all this way in accordance with its orders. They had probably been given this mission because they were particularly faithful and duty-minded troops. It seems they couldn't just argue to a foreigner's proposal to embezzle and split up the gold. And San Angelo looked like he was doing all he could to calm the unexpectedly fervent rage of his subordinates. Looks like the gold is blinding them too. It seems no one can sort out their own personal feelings in the way they want to be perceived.
Yeah, no,
there's a lot of people that would fight for a lot less.
後ろ見よ!
B ちゃん、注意が。返事を求めてる。
考える時間が欲しいと言ってるわ。私はあなたと話せたから気が紛れてよかったけれど、他の人たちはそうじゃないの。とても長い航海の果てに大勢の仲間を失って極限状態でここにいるわ。唯一の心の拠り所だった任務ももはや喪失してる。どうすればいいのか彼らも分かってないの。
注意、彼らは時間が欲しいと言っています。
いいとも、大いに議論したらいい。しかし時間はないぞ。隠すとなったら時間と手間がかかる。明日の正午までに結論しろ。異常だ、イタリア人ども。
回答期限は明日の正午だそうだ。注意ね、まるで脅迫だ。
少尉は全員の意見を聞くと言ってるわ。
感触は？
多分難航するわ。少尉自身は山分けもあり得ると考えてるみたいだけど、下士官や他の仲間たちは多分反対するわ。みんなこの極東までの航海で大切な仲間を大勢失ってる。彼らは頑なに祖国への忠誠を貫きたがってる。
注意の申し出は断ると。
断ってもどうせ黄金は誰かの手に渡るわ。何も残らないなら、せめてインゴットの一本ずつでも密かに持ち帰ろうという少尉の言い分に同調者も出そうだけど、こういう時の男って勢いだけが迷走するわ。私も見当がつかない。
イタリア人たちの胸中は複雑でしょうね。
彼らにとって降伏後のイタリアは敵国同然だろう。黄金をそのイタリアに返還するのは彼らの長い旅路を全て否定するのと同じだ。
しかし黄金を着服して山分けすることも彼らの旅路の否定になります。
彼らが義理立てすべき祖国はすでに滅んで、その時点で彼らの旅路の意味などもう失われてる。気の毒な話だ。
どうせ意味のないことなら インゴットの一本でもありつけた方がまだマシだと。
損得感情で言えばそうなる。そうならねえのが男ってもんだがな。
The Italians were gathered in a cramped room, arguing fiercely.
反対です。死んだ戦友たちのためにも断固軍人魂を貫くべきです。
貫くとはどういうことか。この島に黄金を隠せということか。東洋人たちの申し出を受けるということか。
東洋人たちは信用できません。特にあの山本という男、断じて油断できません。
黄金を荷上げして日本人たちに見られたのはやはり失敗でした。
Yeah, I know, I was about to say, this is... These are Italians here.
艦と共に沈めるべきでした。
日本人の基地で沈めてどうする。やがていつかは引き上げられる。隠したことにはなれない。いずれにせよ、この島から黄金を誰にも知られずに運び出す方法はない。
洋上で名誉ある自陳を選んでいたらこんなことには。
艦のダメージが致命的だったことがあの時点で分かっていたら、どうしてあの時少佐は日本軍に救援要請を。日本軍にこの黄金のことを知られたら、少佐はどう任務を遂行するつもりだったんだ。
少佐が救援要請を出した時点で我々の任務はもう失敗していたんだ。諸君にも祖国で待つ家族がいるはずだ。そして極東の島国までよく後悔に耐えた。それに対するこれは正当な報酬なのだという考え方もある。
あの時日本人に助けな
きゃ。絶対に反対だ。
Italian Japanese shatter.
親友たちが浮かばれるんで
こんな目に。
少尉、日本人が友好的でない場合、我々は最終的解決手段を辞さない覚悟が必要です。
伍長、最終的解決手段とは何か。
Someone gulped. Stiff tension hung over the room.
日本人たちはたるみきっています。実戦経験もない腰抜けばかりです。我々は精兵です。すでに基地内の間取りのほぼ全てと日本人の人数、配置状況は把握しています。少尉の命令があれば短時間で制圧できるでしょう。戦闘員と思わしきは山本を含めて数人程度、残りは軍属の作業員風情です。上辺の人数は日本人が上ですが、実質兵力ではこちらが優位です。
日本人を殺せば迎えの船が来た時それをどう説明する。
They all died of suicide. Two bullets to the back of the head.
ごまかしようがないぞ。
死体さえ見つからなければどうとでもごまかせます。少尉、この基地を制圧するのは容易です。山本以下主要な兵士数人を殺してみせれば、あっさりと作業員たちは降伏するでしょう。彼らに黄金を運ばせ地中に埋めましょう。もちろん彼らの口は永遠に塞ぎますが。
日本人たちを皆殺しにするということか。
Thank you.
殺しましょう。全員殺せば黄金のことは誰にも知られずに済むのです。
At that moment, the door which had been supposedly locked opened slightly and a metal object was thrown in.
グラナダ!
Yep.As the yell rang out, the table was kicked over to be used as a shield, and they all dropped to the floor. However, in this cramped room, it probably wouldn't do them any good. Ooh. The Italians were all prepared for death.
不発! 不発!
Fortunately, the shoddy grenade was a dud.The door was slammed open, and three Japanese soldiers wielding pistols jumped in.
Ksottare! Italia-jin domo! Korose! Korose! Korose!
Hōsen shiro! Kakuji 18 bō!
Thank goodness for brackets. In the small room, no matter who shot where, it was bound to hit someone. The exchange of bullets instantly caused a rain of blood, with casualties on both sides. The three who had jumped in were covered with bullet holes and fell over, moaning and thrashing.
Gino! Gino!
I don't know if the correct course of action was to wander and saying, "Oh no, it's a dud. Kill the Italians." The grenade was still rolling about on the floor. It had been a surprise attack. Lieutenant Yamamoto had probably judged that the negotiations would not go his way, and had decided to make the first move. Or else maybe he had been planning from the beginning to put them in a position where they would be gathered in one place to discuss his offer. Broken Jima was their island. If they killed all of the Italians, then not half, but all of the gold would go to the Japanese. There was a chance the grenade might go off late. The Italians rushed out into the corridor. They heard gunfire from down the hallway. Yeah, I wonder why they used one grenade. You know, two would have been a good backup. Just in case someone managed to survive the first blast. They heard gunfire from down the hallway. It was coming from the direction of the submarine dock. Clearly, the troops guarding the pile of gold were being attacked.
Shoui, gomere wo!
Yamu oen! Nihonjin wa korose!
あいつなってきます。この連中ただの船乗りじゃねえ。なるほど。黄金の番人を任されるだけの兵士ということか。人数はこちらが上だ。焦らず囲んで殺せ。イタリア人狩りだ。
As soon as I heard the sound of repeated gunfire, I knew that something which had been smoldering since the time the gold was unloaded had finally burned. When looking at the gold, the eyes of our soldiers hadn't been normal. Yes, those eyes had been entranced by demons. The Italians had been pushed to the limits by the heavy burden they bore. Who wouldn't have snapped after being trapped in a distant land where you can't understand the language or the writing? Thinking I had to do something, I ran towards the sound of gunfire. Looking back on it, that was an extremely stupid thing to do. That sound meant that there were people shooting at each other. People killing each other. And yet, unarmed as I was, I dashed towards the sound as though I was trying to mediate some schoolyard fight. It didn't take long before I learned how foolish and naive such a thing was in the heat of battle.
Hiraoka Heizo!
Warrant Officer Hiroka was lying face down, his entire body drenched in blood. Judging by the trail of blood behind him, it was clear that he had somehow managed to crawl here from a different room before dying. No, he was still twitching. He might not be dead yet, but on this island without a doctor... No, even if we had a doctor, how could anyone possibly save a man who had been shot this many times in the chest? When I looked into the room he must have crawled out of, I saw two more blood-stained Japanese corpses. Now he sounds like battling now. I fell backwards, pathetically on my butt, my mouth hanging open in shock. Come to think of it, that was the first time I had ever faced death in my life. The entire world was at war. Even though millions were dying, both east and west, This was the first time I had met with a person's death directly. Ridiculous. Didn't I join the army hoping to die? I know he sounded like Battler earlier, but he sounds like Battler more when he's like freaking out about dead people. Yeah, so rejoice, Kanzo. Isn't this the death you were looking for? Why not spread your hands and yell out loud? Come for me, magnificent death! Someone came running towards me. It was a colleague of mine, a Japanese man. Hajime-kun. He dashed towards me, pale-faced and out of breath. His face seemed horribly contorted with terror. Mine probably looked the same.
Tajima-kun, what happened?
People died. Someone yelled in Italian, and at the same time, Hajime-kun let out a scream. Then he grabbed onto me as he fell to the floor. A red stain was spreading across his back before my eyes.
Tajima!
As he spat bubbles of blood, he said that one word. In Italian, shoot someone. But the shock of seeing someone die right in front of me did not freeze my heart. At a fundamental level, all living things aren't concerned with the deaths of others. The one thing that matters is whether they themselves die or not. It was the barrel of the gun the Italian soldier was pointing that froze my heart. Tajima-kun's back burst once more as he leaned against me. Flesh tore, blood splattered. The warm splash of it covered my face. Was the Italian still trying to finish him off, even though he'd stopped moving for good? How foolish I've been. Can I still not understand the scene in front of me? Rejoice, Kanzo. Now you'll finally get what you've wanted all this time. The Italian hadn't fired to finish off Tajima-kun. He had been aiming at the man Tajima-kun had fallen on, me, Ushirimiya Kanzo. I pushed his corpse aside, scrabbled against the floor, and dashed away, tumbling over myself. More Italian. My hands had pushed off against the floor hard enough to tear off the ring finger fingernail on my left hand. Ow. When faced with death, humans truly can resist with all they've got. I tumbled over and over as I ran, scraping up parts of my body. It was painful, hot, but that didn't matter at all. I heard the yelling in Italian come from behind me over and over again. It felt like they were running, chasing after me. This screaming garlic bread at you. I didn't want to look back, so I kept on running and running, as though the Italians were right behind me. This is death. Didn't you want to die? No, I don't want to die. Why? Didn't I want to die so badly? But now I know. I know how wonderful it is to be alive. She taught me. Beatrice did. I don't want to say that name because I don't like how it sounds. She can only be free when I talk to her. No, by talking with her, I was finally alive for the first time. I was born. I want to live. I want to live. I want to live. I want to live. I don't want to die. I want to live and see her right now. If I don't see her, I'll die. I'll be killed. Stay cool, Kanzo. She might be killed too. If you live and she dies, you might as well be dead. Why, before I knew it, my face was covered in tears, not drool.
What?
When I stumbled onto something and fell, I was finally able to come to my senses a little. I could still hear intermittent gunfire. The gunfight was still going on, and it had spread throughout the entire base. Beatrice, are you okay? I'll find her and take her to a safe place. The lieutenant will probably kill all of the Italians to steal the gold. Beatrice probably won't be an exception.
Beat.
I lived for the first time after meeting you. I was born. So if you die, I'll die again. I could feel every cell in my body being reborn. Not as Ushir Miyakinzo, but as a completely different Kinzo. Of course, I was terrified that I might really be shot if I went back. But I didn't want to die anymore. I could truly die. So, I was able to overcome my fear.
Rubens!
People are being shot. People are killed when they die. Reuben stood with Beatrice behind his back. Reubens. And neatly shot the two men rushing at him with two 9mm bullets from his Beretta M1934. However, one of the 8mm bullets from their Type 94 semi-auto pistols went straight into Reuben's chest. All three of the shooters were struck in the chest and fell down in a heap. There you go. The Witch of the Forest. The next person to appear is the commanding officer of the Japanese soldiers, Yamamoto. The blast of the three guns had just sounded. Adding on Beatrice's screams, it was hardly surprising that he had noticed the encounter. Yamamoto spat. Beatrice used that moment to snatch up Reuben's gun. He spat this last part at the two dying men who lay moaning at his feet. However, it wasn't particularly surprising. And this wasn't the first time it had happened. In this tiny cramped tunnel, nearly everyone had met head-on. When both sides shot recklessly in the situation, the result was two corpses. So whoever sensed another person and pulled the trigger quickest won. That was the only way to survive this battle without a bullet in your chest. Because of this, both Japanese and Italians have killed each other without hesitation, and they sometimes even pulled the trigger on incoming allies. In the midst of all this were several Japanese men who had stumbled onto the fight, wondering what was going on. It didn't matter whether the other person was holding a gun or not. Everyone had reflexively pulled the trigger at the sight of anyone other than themselves trying to stay alive. The entire base had been wrapped up in the slaughter. kind of seems familiar to what happens in the mansion, doesn't it? Just a little bit. There was a fierce gun battle taking place in the submarine dock. And a massacre resembling a hunt was taking place inside the base. Most of the non-combatants assigned to this base were killed before they knew what was going on. The Italians were indeed quite seasoned troops, but their numbers began to drop bit by bit. Blood-stained corpses were scattered all across the base. At first, it had probably been a proper gunfight. However, as their minds began to grow weary and numb, it devolved into that most basic cause of wars throughout humanity. The desire to kill all foreigners you don't understand. Whenever they heard words they didn't understand, they pulled the trigger. By that point, the screams of foreigners sounded no different from those of man-shaped beasts. After all, they couldn't understand pleading in another language. So it had long ago turned into a mere massacre. As the number of dead surpassed the number of living, silence began to return to the base. Just when it felt as though everyone had died and the desolate sound of the wind blew throughout the caves, there would be a sudden scream, the crisp sound of a gun, and one would remember that the massacre wasn't yet over. This happened over and over again, and eventually true silence fell. It marked the pitiful end for those led astray by gold. That was good timing, you're right, on the gunshot and the music. The leader of the Italian soldiers, Angelo, had managed to survive somehow. He encountered nothing but the corpses of friend and foe. All was quiet once more in the base. If he was careless enough to call out, he might be shot from the shadows somewhere. So he snuck about like a panther, breathing quietly and searching for the remaining enemies. There was no sign or trace of any living person. Maybe all of the people in this base had died. The Japanese struck first. But at that time, we were also talking about killing them. They simply made the first move as military men. So perhaps we should be grateful to them. By the time the boat came to take us away, there would have been no honor for us. We would have been mere failures in our mission, unfit to face our dead comrades. Perhaps dying here in the Far East alongside my gun is a more fitting end for a soldier. I noticed the sound of shuffling feet coming from around the corner and strained to hear. Is someone seriously wounded and dragging their feet? Noticing them before they notice me greatly helps my chances. At this stage, there's no point in taking prisoners. We must dispose of all the Japanese. I'll dash around the corner, quickly check to see who they are, and shoot if it's a Japanese person. Nothing more. I've been hiding my footsteps the whole time. They probably don't know I'm here. Once the shuffling footsteps had come close enough, Angelo leaned around the corner and raised his gun. The voice that reached him spoke Italian. Yep, I kind of figured that was going to happen.
Kisama o sagashiteita zo, Angelo Shoi. これで全員だな。俺はしっかり貴様らの死体を数えて回ってたんだからな。
しっかりして!アンジェロ少尉!
Blood poured from Angelo's chest. His gun fell to the floor, then his knees, and the rest of his body crumpled and stopped moving. Yamamoto's accuracy with a gun wasn't particularly stellar. However, Angelo had waited until they were fairly close before jumping out, so Yamamoto had made the shot. He'd managed to hit, even with a short-barreled handgun in one hand, and a woman as a hostage in the other.
それにしても我が六軒島守備隊の情けないことよ。まさか私以外は全員死んだのではあるまいな。やれやれクズど。
女を盾に取らなきゃ戦えない人手なし。離して。
静かにしろ。イタリア女は実に騒がしい。おとなしくしてれば命までは取らんという。
It was such an obvious lie that even he wore a bitter smile. The Italians were spies working for the enemy, and they all died along with the garrison in a gunfight. Since this was a story Yamamoto wanted to tell, he couldn't afford to have any Italian survivors. By this point, he wouldn't be able to keep the entire pile of gold. But he should be able to grab as many as he could carry. Even that would be worth a huge amount of money. Beatrice suddenly swung her head, smashing Yamamoto's nose hard. She almost managed to escape. DeVito headbutt. However, Yamamoto quickly grabbed her leg and tripped her. She fell onto her back, and Yamamoto mercilessly stomped his foot down on her stomach and pointed his gun at her.
Jajauma wo kai narasu shumi wa nai no de na. Kisama wa shine!
Tsui! Kanoja wa mukankei da! Hanashite yare!
Kinzo had jumped out of the shadows. He was holding a gun he had stolen from one of the corpses.
Hmm? Ushiro miyaka? Oh, ikite otta.
Kanoja wa hanase! Kurushigatte!
Kisama de aro. イタリア人どもに攻撃があることを密告したの
だ。何の話だ。
Yamamoto didn't know that the grenade had been a dud. Surprise attack, which he had been certain would work, had failed. So he decided that Kinzo must have tipped them off.
貴様のせいで奇襲が失敗してこのざまだ。この裏切り者め。貴様がこのイタリア女を通じて内通していたことはお見通しよ。
あなたが黄金に目がくらんだからこの事態を招いたのではないのか。
逃げて金蔵。この男は命乞いしてる人も撃ったわ。
Has he? I guess maybe he's run into a couple people.
あなたも撃たれる。
喋るなイタリア女。もう一度口を聞いたら容赦なく撃つぞ。
Yamamoto ground his heel into Beatrice's gut.
よせ、やめろ。彼女は何の関係もない。
銃を上官に向けるとはどういうこと。頭を冷やせ愚か者め。私とお前で口裏を合わせる。あの黄金の山は私たちだけのものではないか。私一人では少々くすねるくらいしかできんが、お前と二人でならもっと多くの数をくすねることができる。
Wouldn't want to shoot the Japanese Navy Commander in Chief just then and there like that.
上官面をするつもりはないぞ。男同士二人できっちり山分けしようじゃねえ。
ゴブゴブに分けようと言ってあなたは彼らの寝首をかこうとしたのではないのか。
後ろ見、どうやら貴様は黄金より鉛の方がお好みらしいな。
Oh, I like that line. Without any hesitation, Yamamoto raised the barrel of his gun towards Kinzo. and pulled the trigger. It grazed Kinzo's right ear. If Yamamoto's aim had been just a bit better, the bullet would have slammed into Kinzo's face.
Kinzo! Yokumo!
Kisama!
Not letting Yamamoto's momentary distraction go to waste, Beatrice lashed out and planted her right foot in Yamamoto's crotch. After moaning in pain, demonic expression flashed across Yamamoto's face and he stomped on her chest.
Mite!
Come
on, Kinzo. We got it. There you go. Beatrice shut her eyes tightly, hoping that she could withstand the coming pain. No one would want to have their eyes open at the moment they've been shot. Now they get all the gold for themselves. A blood splash poured out of Yamamoto's chest. Could Yamamoto hear Kinzo's words until the end? In his last moments, Yamamoto seemed to grin. Then slowly, he fell backwards with a spurt of blood. I mean, he has been shot. His ear got grazed. Beatrice tried to stand up, but then doubled over and started coughing.
Bise! Kega o shita no ka?
Abara ga itamu wa. Sono hitodenashi ga hageshiku funda mono da kara.
Daijoubu ka? Orete inakereba ii nda ga.
これくらいで折れるほどイタリア女はヤワじゃないの。でもありがとう。あなたは命の恩人だわ。あなたが来なければ私はきっとそこに転がっていたわ。
Yamamoto had shown no mercy. Her ribs were probably cracked.He didn't have the option of waiting, possibly for several days, for the ship that was coming. We made the decision to carry her away from this island. Or I did. The man who kept yelling about preserving the secrecy of the base is lying there dead. The next island over, Nijima, is close. A small boat should be able to take us there.
Kimi o byouin e hakoba nakereba naranai. Kimi ga omotte iru yori.傷が深かったらいけない。
知らなかった。この島には病院もあるのね。
ない。隣の島へ船で運ぶ。君は病院へ。私はこの島での出来事をうまく片付けないと。とばっちりで軍法会議者だ。
頼みがあるの。私を病院へ連れて行かないで。
どうして？
病院へ行って大使館に連絡が行けば私はやがて本国へ送還されるわ。そしてきっとあれこれと尋問を受けるんだわ。私はママを見殺しにした奴らを自分の祖国とは認めないの。もう私の帰るべき祖国はないの。ここが私の終点。
What are my thoughts and set on battle setting of the events of episode 6? I'm sure I'll have more interesting thoughts after I figured out, you know, the entire story. But I don't really. I don't really know. I liked that he took away your duct tape. Or, you know, made your duct tape not work, and then I was mad that he made it work again. That's about all I really got.
だからもう、私はどこへも行きたくないの。私に優しくしてくれた、アンジェロ少尉も、ルーベンスも、みんなみんな。
Everyone else without names.
死んでしまった。
だから、君までここで死ぬと。
Oh, the whole idea of Battler trapping himself in the logic error on purpose? Foolish, but, you know, fits Battler's style pretty well. And, you know, it's kind of important to figuring out more of the story.
イタリア女はヤワじゃないんだろ?生きるんだ。
ねえ、金蔵。生きるってどういう意味?あなたが教えてくれたはずよ。生きるってのは、ただ息をすることじゃないわ。私は、イタリアへ帰りたくないの。
ビーチェ。
あなたは私と出会うまで、死んでいたと言ってくれたわ。でも、それは私も同じなの。潜水艦の中で、私は死んでいた。祖国も滅び、ママも死んだ。パパもね。私は、こんな船沈んでしまえと願ったわ。だから、ここにたどり着いたとき、実は死に損ねたとがっかりした。その矢先よ、少尉が英語がわかる者はいるかと騒ぎ出したの。
When Kinzo met Beatrice, he finally forgot about dying. And when Beatrice met Kinzo, she also forgot about dying.
私は祖国も家族も友人たちも失った私をあなたにさらってほしいと願うの。
ピーちゃん。
でもそれは叶えられない望みだとも分かってる。ならばせめて迎えの船が来るまでの数日間をあなたと一緒にいたいの。胸の痛みなんて気にしない。だって迎えの船に連れ去られたら私はもう死んでしまうのだから。
Beatrice spoke this, smiling softly. She did her best to hide the pain in her chest.
お願い、金蔵。迎えが来るまでの数日間でいいから、私をさらって。
その願いは叶えられない。
Looking apologetic.Kinzo lifted Beto up and gently sat her in the boat.
Ikujinashi. Yappari Nihon no otoko wa nanjaku da wa.
Sou da na. Watashi wa Ikujinashi da. Dakara kimi no negai wa katahou shika kanaerarenai.
With a clunk, he placed it wrapped in a jacket in the boat.
Katahou to wa?
迎えが来るまでの数日間でいいからの方は叶えられないということさ。
え?どういう意味?
君をさらう、そっちを叶えることにした。
Oh, how romantic!
金蔵!
There has to be a doctor on Nijima. I'm wearing a navy uniform.Should be able to pass myself off as a survivor of a boat carrying a VIP that was sunk by enemy ships. The doctor happens to be of the greedy sort, all the better. After all, I have right here the golden magic to make people do what I say. the witch from a distant country who took my lifeless body and gave me a soul. The woman who came to me with the gold revived me with her magic. Yes, I'm waiting for Nanjo. I'm pretty sure it was going to be Nanjo.
ええ、黄金の魔女よ。みんなと同じレシピで作ってるのに、私だけがパスタから消し炭を生み出す錬金術が使えるの。
あなたと同じく私も、あなたがいてくれる限り生きることを許される屍。あなたがいなくなったら、私はすぐにでも死んでしまう。死なせない。本当に？絶対に。だってね、だってあなたは私をさらったんだから。
And they lived happily ever after on the island. And he hid all the gold underground somewhere, probably.
So, this car. Kinzo-san ga soko made hanashimashita ka?
Are we getting close to a good spot to stop, or was that it? Oh, I could see us stopping pretty soon if they, like, we're gonna finish this up really quick. I just wanna make sure before I keep going. That was interesting. I liked that. That was really cool. This part isn't too long? Alright, we'll go through it. That was really cool, though. I really liked just that whole story you told. That was super cool. I didn't really expect that, you know? This episode's turning out to be a whole lot of interesting stuff.
では、まさかあなたなのですか?
おじいさまがベアトリーチを連れて行った新島の医者というのは驚くに値しねえ。新島の医者ってピンとくる。突然海軍の兵隊さんが外国人の女性を連れて現れたのです。驚きましたとも。しかもその上軍機なので秘密で治療しろというのです。それが
Have I figured anything out about the explosion? I mean, knowing that there is a military base on this island, it's conceivable that there's some kind of bomb or grenade or something. Though I think it'd be more powerful than a grenade if it made, like, the entire mansion go down. So maybe there is some kind of large bomb hidden somewhere.
そうです。それが金蔵さんと初めての対面でした。黄金で言いなりになった欲深な医者ってのもお前のことなのか。これは手厳しいですな。突然外国人の女性患者を連れ込み、軍機だから秘密にせよと言い、治療代は必ず持ってくるから担保にと言って 黄金のインゴットを差し出す相手ですぞ。厄介事は語源でした。しぶしぶとですとも。確かにそれもそうですね。A collection
of small bombs. I certainly hope so.
でも南條先生はベアトリーチをかくまってくれたんですね。金蔵さんほどではありませんが、私にも英語の心得がありました。
二人の会話を漏れ聞き、二人が決して厄介な何者かでないと確信したからです。もちろんインゴットに目がくらまなかったといえば嘘がすぎますがな。私も今よりは若かったものですから。その後彼女しばらくの療養の後、後宮家の使いの方が来て 小田原に移すとおっしゃいましてな。引き取られていきました。おじいさまが自分で迎えに行ったわけではないのですか?
Kinzo がどう六軒島の事件を言い訳したにせよ。
Kinzo is busy trying to set himself up a big mansion on an island somewhere.
しばらくの間は自由には動けなかっただろうよ。
ですな。軍をごまかすのが金蔵さんの人生で一番の大勝負だったと言っておりましたが。
ベアトリーチェは小田原に行って、それから
使われていない別荘の一つにかくまったと聞いています。当時の金蔵さんにはもう家族がおられましたからな。そこはうまくやられたのでしょうが。
クアドリアン以前から二重生活はお手の物だったというわけだ。
そ、
何してるんですか？お尻におできでも？
ち、
それからベアトリーチェはおじい様の保護で別荘でいつまでも
平穏に、つつましやかに暮らしたと聞きます。
その娘こそクアドリアンのベアトリーチェか。
ナイス。
金蔵さんの前では気丈に振る舞われていたそうですが、お気の毒なことです。
まさか亡くなったんですか？
驚くな。金蔵はその娘を生まれ変わりと信じたんだぞ。心をないがしろにするんじゃねえ。推理は可能だ。
そうですね。失礼。
私は金蔵さんが彼女と過ごされた小田原の数年間を知りません。しかしその後の今日までの金蔵さんを見れば、ほんの数年間であっても彼がいかに彼女を深く愛したか伺い知ることができるでしょう。
そうですね。
そしてその娘のためにクアドリアンを作ったというわけか。
金蔵さんは潜水艦の黄金を元手に巧みに立ち回り、たちまちのうちに財産を築き上げていきました。また持ち前の英語力を生かし、 GHQ に強いコネクションを作って、みるみるうちに大富豪となられたのです。この辺はリオンさんに説明する必要はありますまい。
ええ、その莫大な財産で六軒島を買い取り、屋敷を建てます。小田原の親族たちは無人島を丸ごと買い取ったおじい様を水郷だと笑ったそうです。
10トンの黄金がポケットに収まる大きさだったなら、金蔵も島を買わなかったのよ。
He hid the gold somewhere in Rokenjima. Built up a fortune with the ingots he'd taken out of it. And then bought up the whole treasure island.
ですな。そして、後宮家の黄金伝説が始まるのです。
インゴットには、片翼のわしが刻印されていたと聞くが。
片翼のわしというよりは、片翼に見えてしまうわしというべきでしょうな。
それはどういう意味ですか？
ヨーロッパに多いでしょう。翼を広げたわしを紋章にしたものは、サロ共和国の国旗にもわしが、いやいや鷹でしたかな、が刻まれています。
刻印が薄かった、あるいは粗雑だったということか。
I feel like I'm not much gold. Poorly doing an imprint is like something that you wouldn't do. That's a lot of money.
そうです。戦時下の粗雑な刻印でした。
Okay, whatever.
本来は翼を広げたわしの紋章が刻印されるべきだったのでしょう。それがちょうど斜めに立ち切ったように半分薄れて消えていたのです。
翼を広げたわしが半分消えて、それが片翼のわしに見えた。
It was all an accident.
金蔵は自分の運命を大きく変えたベアトリーチェの黄金に片翼のわしを見て、それを自分の紋章とすることを決めたに違いあるまい。
He stole it from them. Excellent. Good work, 金蔵。
果たして正しく刻印されていたなら、それは 共和国旗の鷹だったのか。それともまさか総統の。いやいや、そんなまさか。あの莫大な黄金の山の前で金蔵さんと杯を傾け合いながら黄金ロマンで夜を明かすのはなかなかに楽しいことでした。もっとも金蔵さんはその刻印から黄金の出所を探られることを嫌いましてな。外部に持ち出す黄金にはわざわざ自分の型欲のわしをデザインした別の刻印を打ち直していたようですが。
Good job, Kinzo.
お前には見せるだけだったのか。金蔵もケチだな。
無論、大富豪になった後、金蔵さんは再び私の元へ訪れ、未払いだった治療費をしっかり払ってくれましたとも。治療費にはちと多すぎましたのでな。ちゃんとお釣りを払いましたが。
それ以来、おじい様と交流を。
そうです。金蔵さんは私が秘密を守ってベアトリーチェをかくまったことをことのほか深く感謝してくれましてな。
おじい様はかつての小田原の親族たちは欲深の嘘つきばかりだとおっしゃっていました。南條先生の義理堅さが嬉しかったに違いありません。おじい様のような方がどうしてあなたにだけは心を開いたのかわかる気がします。
私にも多少の異国趣味とチェスの趣味がありましてな。金蔵さんとは以来息を統合しまして、こうして細々と、しかし気づけば随分と長くお付き合いをさせてもらっています。
大きな金を扱うやつほど小さな金にもきっちりしてる。治療費以上をもらおうとしなかったあんたの律儀さに惹かれるところもあったんだろうよ。
とんでもない。大きなお金に怯えてしまっただけです。後になってから後悔しましたとも。どうにも昔から肝が小さいものでしてな。
そんなことはね。肝は十分に不定さ。
そうでしょうか。お世辞でも嬉しいですね。
世辞じゃねえ。
For at least one whole year after Kinzo's death, Nanji had taken part in hiding the secret of that death. Of course, Natsui must have given him some hush money. Still, there could be no doubt that he had enough guts to withstand the pressure from Kinzo's children for a long time without slipping up once.
大した肝っ玉じゃねえか。義理がたいのがお前の性分なんだろうよ。
それしか取り柄がないものでして。
おじい様は良い友人に恵まれたと思います。
There you go. I actually really liked that section. That section was super cool.
おじい様にとって。
So is that going to be all? All for Kinzo's story?Yeah, I would think that maybe that explosion had something to do with some kind of military munitions of some sort. It would be understandable in that way. Is it good? Yeah, you wanted me to go read the chapter? Give me a link. You might have to break it down, like usual, but give me a link. I'll do it. Assuming it doesn't take, like, an hour.And the links you were providing before kept not working. I think it might be blocked in the US, possibly. I'm gonna go go ahead and save. Definitely gives some more insight into sort of why the island is built as it is. Like, that's a lot of work for a secret island that, you know, secret part of the island that Kinzo lives on. And it kind of seemed unbelievable. I mean, I know he's got a lot of money, but that is a lot of work at the same time. And it makes sense that it was a military installation that was supposed to be kept secret. That makes a bit more sense. Because there's a lot of workers there. Yeah, most of the links you normally send me don't work. And he can't transport the gold. That makes sense why he bought the island. He didn't buy the island because he particularly wanted a deserted island. I mean, it works well for trying to keep this existence of gold a secret. But it's simply because taking it off the island would have required a lot of resources. You can't really just take much gold via rowboat, which would be one way of going. You would have to have some kind of large ship or a submarine, which I think would draw a lot of attention, trying to get either of those. It's kind of hard to do that by yourself. And even once you do get these, you have to dock in a port of some sort. You can't just, like, you know, come onto an island with a large boat or a submarine. You have to go into some kind of port. And then trying to unload the gold, I mean, it's such a massive operation, it's not even funny. You got a link for me yet? Yeah, and then people would find out. That's the other thing, is even with transporting the gold, somebody's eventually going to find out, either by him needing help to transport it due to its weight and size and stuff, or just simply due to, you know, someone seeing him unloading it himself. Yeah, you can't post links here. You've got to post them as a link, but you've got to, like, here. Yeah, you gotta, like, do it something like this. Maybe I might be able to show you. Maybe that'll work. Yeah, you gotta post it kind of like that. Yeah, take out brackets and slashes, apparently. I've got to, like, reconstruct it once you actually get it to me. That's an excellent flag, thank you. Alright, let's try that one. I really wish there was an option. I don't mind links being put in, at least for right now. Maybe my mind would change on that later if it became a problem. But there doesn't seem to be a way to allow me to make that happen. Alright, which one of these am I reading? I'll read, like, one of them. I don't think that'll take too long. Go ahead and close Umineko, and in the background I'm gonna go ahead and pull back some of that music I was using. The Valentine's Day one? The Seven Sisters Valentine? Yeah, Let's see if I can get a screen cap of this. Okay, that's kind of working. It's being aggravating, though. How do I change the size? How many have I read anyway? Only the one that I was told about before. Should also then read the White Day since a direct continuation. White Day first? Okay. Sorry, I'm still trying to set up this capture. It's the new version of OBS. So it's kind of weird. Not really new, that's not the right way to say that, but there was a button somewhere in here. Like a resize of some sort. Valentine's first? Oh gosh, now people are confusing me. Whoa, what's that? No. What is that? I don't know what this is. Get out of here. Can I not resize this? Transform. Lock preview. There we go. Okay. Let's try that just so we can actually see what we're looking at a little bit. And maybe move that to the center. Alright, let's try that. So I was told Valentine's Day first? Alright, cool. We'll take a look. Trying to think. Yeah, because I don't want this to be too zoomed out, because it's kind of hard to read on, like, smaller screens if anyone's watching this on smaller screen. So, I want this to be zoomed in a little bit. Alright, and keep in mind, because I am doing this live, I might find it somewhat difficult to come up with super great, like, thoughts about this. Now, madams and misses sitting in front of the TV, are you with me? You've heated up all the chocolate to the point of it melting. Carefully mix it in the bowl with cold water. Mix and mix so that the once melted feelings of men won't go cold. Once the temperature is done, squeeze out the chocolate into circle shapes, then put various decorations on the top and let it cool in the fridge. Almonds, pistachios, cashew nuts. You can also decorate them with Datura seeds and the flowers of Brugmansia. Don't eat them. Yeah, I figured people would be leaving. That's okay. Valentine's Day is a celebration of a maiden's dream. Oh, I forgot. I was going to put on background music. Let me do that really quick. Here. Let's see. We'll just do the same songs again. There's another one as well that I skipped on using because I had enough songs. There we go. And maybe turn down the volume a bit. Let's try that. I deeply hope from the bottom of my heart that you will remember this special day for the rest of your life. Now once you've put it in a cute box and added some wrappings, the Valentine's chocolate is done. Whew, with this, my lady should be delighted as well. Make some delicious chocolate, Renove. When does this take place in, by the way? If anyone could give me sort of a frame of reference. It'd be better if my lady could make her own chocolate Valentine's chocolates by herself. But there are times when my shabby chocolate is able to capture a man's heart as well. Now, that's enough. It's time for you to come out. I'll share some with all of you, seven sisters. Very menacing love. Oh, Ronove-sama, you're too generous. We're terribly sorry for doing something as foolish as spying on you. No, it's all quite all right. It's given for a maiden's heart to beat faster than usual on Valentine's Day. The fact that you're all so deeply interested is only natural. Ronove-sama, is it okay to eat this chocolate? Can't you act a bit more mature, Belize? Don't count your chickens before they're hatched. Now, I certainly would share this chocolate with you all, but listen, everyone. This is Valentine's chocolate, is it not? This chocolate is for the sake of the wonderful day of girls giving chocolate to boys. I see. So you want us to deliver this chocolate to boys? It isn't delivering. It's giving chocolate as a present to a boy you like. Pre-episode 4? Okay. It's finally the long-awaited Valentine's Day, is it not? The world is but a cruel place where it's either kill or be killed. Kill, kill. You all should enjoy these bittersweet feelings of a maiden every once in a while, too. Oh, how wonderful! Thank you so much, Ronove-sama! I wonder who I should give chocolate out to! Good girl, good girl. That's right, it seems Osmo is the most obedient one. Now, everyone, if there's no one you're interested in, it's okay to give it to a woman as well. Now, give it to at least one person, if you don't. If we don't... stare. So, you heard what he said. I trust you all to carry out this mission diligently. That is all. Now go! Yes, Onesama! Well, that said, deciding on whom to give it to won't be that easy. I've already made up my mind. Huh? Who? The wonderful prince on a white horse who made his appearance in episode 4. Of course I'm talking about Imakusa Juza-sama. He's also good at operating vehicles. Great face. He's good looking, stoic but wild, yet not too rude. Ah, how wonderful. Well, he's just like a former mercenary. Then I'll be the first one. Imakusa-sama, please accept this Valentine's Day chocolate. These are the best faces. She sure has some guts, huh? Isn't she embarrassed in the least about this whole giving out chocolate thing? I guess the whole shyly wait behind a tree strategy isn't that popular nowadays. Shouldn't she be at least a little shyer about this? Seriously, kids these days. Imakusa Daddy? I couldn't tell. Thanks, cute young lady. Did you make this yourself? Yes, I made it just for your sake, Imakusa-sama. That girl, lying with the straight face. Imakusa has no way knowing if she made it herself or not. It's a devil's proof. She sure seems used to this, though. Now that you mention it, she's been playing... Oh, man, I'm so bad at that. I don't know how to say that one. Galag at late hours? I triggered a flag. She has completely memorized the cliched storyline. Go to sleep quickly. What a terrifying girl. That girl is pretty amazing. I've never felt so intimidated by Osmo before. How nice. This looks so delicious. Why do I have to hand this over? I want to eat it myself. It tasted amazing, young lady. I won't lose you to you when it comes to returning the favor on White Day. Twitch. I see. If I give out these chocolates as a present now, I'll get 3 times the amount in return on White Day. It's just like the Strahl millionaire strategy. The poor man who became rich by doing favors for others and exchanging items with them. Please, you're no fool. You could hold back for 1 month if it's for the sake of sweets. Wait, where are you going? Oh, is this for me? Yes, Goto-sama. I handmade the best chocolate I could while thinking about you. Oh, no. I never imagined I would get chocolate from a young girl at this age. What is this noise? I don't know this music. Stop it. It's a bit embarrassing. She chose the person who would make the most delicious chocolate, huh? She sure is greedy. Now, eat up, and be sure to give me back thrice the amount on White Day. Munch, munch. Oh, these expressions are priceless. Oh, was it not to your tastes? Young lady, did you say you handmade this chocolate? Huh? That's right, I made it myself. Thank you, young lady. It feels like ages since my taste have awoken from my slump. This is no longer a challenge to me. That's right. There's only 1 month until White Day. I'll leave immediately to Belgium for trading. This Goda will definitely not lose when it comes to taste. Ooh! That's probably Goda speaking, not the girl. Shocked. Well, whatever. I'm looking forward to White Day! Uryu! Chocolate! It's not just for you. You have to share it with Angie-sama. Angie will also surely be surprised, Uryu. Huh? Where's Angie-sama? Uryu, she went all the way to Ginza to buy chocolate she could give to Battler and Amakusa. Angie-sama is the type of person to handle these things with money rather than making them herself, huh? I wonder if she'll be home after that, though. Give me your best one. Thank you very much. Uryu! I want to hurry up and eat Mammon's chocolate. How about I give you one bite right now? I'll eat it. What? Then I'll have to take a bite too. I can't hold myself back anymore. Let me fluff you up. Fluff, fluff, fluff. Hey, can I try your ears as well? You can't, Uryu. That Mammon, she's gotten the gist of it. And she's even monopolized Sakutaro. Even though Sakutaro is for all of us. Who's up next? I get the feeling the order is going from the youngest to the oldest. If that's the case, I'll go next. I don't know if it's fair to give chocolate to a married man, but I'll give you this for having been my opponent in the showdown in episode 3. Ooh, I didn't imagine I'd receive chocolate from a young lady. Thanks. So, how have you been after all that? Been doing fine? Yes, well, that kind of things are normal for me. You're way too sincere for a devil, you know. I've met many women like you who take up unnecessary burdens to carry. I was just worried because it looked like a lot of work behind the scenes. You're being a little sly now, but I also think that's cute. I don't know what you mean by sly. You're too close. And that aside, you reek of tobacco. Well, about that. Lend me your ear, I'll whisper it to you. What's with this atmosphere? My ear? Fine. Eek! Oh, so adult-like! That guy's horrible. He's seducing women even though he has a wife. Huh? Levin Nason's not here? I didn't imagine I would end up receiving chocolate from a woman. Thank you. I'm happy. I, who rule over envy, lost in a fight against your envy. For that, I take off my hat to you for the time being. I don't want to be praised for something like that, though. Oh, is this handmade? It looks delicious. Oh, it'll definitely taste great. After all, when Belef gave chocolate to Rudolph just a while back, he said it was delicious. Huh? What's this all about? Well, I just saw it a while ago. Those two over there were... Hey, I wonder if that's really fine. Isn't that cheating? Who's my favorite steak? So far right now, I'm enjoying her. Oh, it's nothing like that. Rudolph Sand is dedicated only to me. He wouldn't do something like cheating. Yeah, that's my master of envy. The numbers increase as your envy keeps burning up. Show me more and more of that charming envy of yours. Thud, thud, thud. Lucini, what's up, Satan? Have you chosen to whom you'll give it? Not yet. To whom I give it? The 14th of February is Valentine's Day. Seven Sisters Valentine's sequel? It's a day where girls give their honest feelings to boys in the form of chocolate. Renove passed out one small box with his handmade chocolate to every sister and ordered them to definitely give it out to at least one person. 5 out of 7 had given out their chocolates with favorable results. Now who was left were... these two awkward sisters. I'm beat. I wonder who it's fine to give it to. Lucini, I'm gonna go... Huh? Who are you gonna give it to? I also have a foe I fought 1-to-1, so... I don't need it. Oh, why? It's not like there's anything suspicious hidden in it. It's just normal chocolate, accept it. I have no reason to accept such a thing from someone like you. Do I need to say it's for Valentine's Day? Just accept it already. Are you purposefully trying to humiliate a woman? You sissy! What'd you say? So you really did just come here to mock me. Disappear. There's nothing I'll accept from you. Chia! What's with you? I'll disappear once I've given you the chocolate. Hurry up and accept this. I'm not doing this because I want to either. Why is he going to these lengths to reject it? Why is she so pressed about this? Kenan-kun, if I... My Lady Jessica! Dash, don't bother Kenan-kun. Just go somewhere else, you furniture of the witch. If it's just you alone, you have no chance against us. I'm furniture, I don't have a mouth. This girl... Oh, my music stopped. Don't we move on to another song? Okay, do this one. It's a good song. Feeling so confident just because she got a power up in episode 4. What's with this? Didn't I come all the way here just to give you chocolate? Why am I the only one it isn't going well for? Disappear. Even if it were just me alone, I could take you on easily. Why? That's because your chocolate probably has some suspicious poison in it. There's no way Kenan-kun would eat something like that. I'm begging you, please, just take it. Just how badly are you trying to humiliate me? You shameless idiots. Baka, Remember this. Next time, I'll kill you for real. Yeah. What was that? Don't ever come here again. Yeah. I wonder if I should return this later. Nuts, a no-no. You can't just eat devil's chocolate. There's definitely something in it. I'll dispose of this myself. I can do that much by myself, you know. I said no. You aren't allowed to touch the box. So, more importantly, Cannon-kun, this, since it's an obligation, I wonder what that person came here for. Wow. How undignified, Satan Onisama. Not being able to give even one chocolate with satisfactory results. How pathetic. What do I do? Things didn't go well for Satan. There's no way it'll go well for me, who has the least competence out of all the sisters. But if I don't hand out chocolate to someone, Runobe-sama will get angry at me. And then all of the sisters, excluding Satan, will look at me with terrible eyes. If it's George, he seems like a friendly person. He's likely to accept it normally. Yay. But Shannon will most definitely come and crash the party uninvited. That girl can be real stubborn at times like these. I'll just say I gave it to someone and quietly go get rid of it. Where do you think you're going, Lucini? I can see through your thinking. You guys, don't let Lucini escape. Yes, Onesima. Hey, Lucifer Onesima. I wonder who Onesima will give out chocolate to. You'll show us an elegant Valentine's Day love fitting for the eldest sister, right? This is bad. They've got me. What do I do? There's no one left I could give it to. To whom will you give it, Onesima? What do I do? What do I do? How are you planning to escape? George's face was really good, wasn't it? It's Battler, come to save the day! Ushirimiya Battler! Oh, it's the Nechans. I thought it was kind of noisy. Getting along like always, I see. What's with this box? Ah, I see it's Valentine's after all. Even though you guys usually say such nasty things, you have a cute side as well. Ushirimiya Battler? Huh? This? Huh? For me? Please, I'm begging you, accept this! Thanks. I'll bury the hatchet just for today. You have my thanks. Huh? Tchah. This is pretty amazing. Did you make it by hand? Well, it is something like that. Ah, so bright! Yep, it's delicious, all right. You have a good sense when it comes to cooking. Ever considered quitting all this dangerous stuff and becoming a regular housewife instead? That is the highest insult you could give to us, furniture. It's unthinkable. Just kidding. Well, thanks for the meal. Look forward to White Day. See you again! Did you see that? For me, Valentine's Day is no big deal. Oh, crap, the song stopped. Let's do that one. That's the last one I got. Hopefully we're done soon. I look forward to what that human will bring me on White Day. You sure did it, just as expected of Lucini. You had good luck just to have Battler conveniently appear like that. Luck is also a merit. how great. How great. How truly great. Now the Seven Stakes of Purgatory have successfully completed their task. Now let us report to Runobe-sama of our successes. Yes, Onesima. Though Satan-ni was pretty terrible, I also sort of gave my piece. This indeed is the most bittersweet day of the year. It's fine to have stories like these every once in a while, isn't it? Giving out the chocolates was a worthwhile experience for me as well. Huh? The punchline? Of course that's included as well. The leading role will be none other than our master. Poo-hoo-hoo. Ah, there he is. Yo, battler. Oh, be... Happy Valentine's! What the heck, Beto? Don't tell me you even brought some chocolate. Just kidding. Coo-hoo-hoo. Be honored, be very honored. Stand straight and do well to accept that. As if you're a witch after all. I bet when I eat it, I'll discover you put some weird poison in it. How rude. Even if you think badly of me, I am a witch who can read the atmosphere. I would love to... What is that? Oh, yeah, I remember that now. I would love to mix in a drug that would make you all submissive, but I would not resort to such heresy. There's no way I could trust you to begin with, but I'll accept your feelings at the very least. Whether or not I eat it is a different matter. Huh? How is it? How is it? Doesn't the chocolate look delicious? So eat it, the chocolate that I put my heart into. This looks exactly like the chocolate I received a while ago. That should have definitely been Lucifer's homemade chocolate. Hey, wait just a minute, Beto. Did you really make this chocolate yourself? Indeed. I prepared them by hand and put all of my emotions into them just for your sake. Repeat it in red. This chocolate was handmade by Beatrice. Why should I? Just like I thought, carelessly saying that you handmade this. But I'm aware. This was handmade by Lucifer, right? Lucifer? Why Lucifer? Lucifer's chocolate was certainly delicious. She acted a bit more ladylike. She could become a great wife with enough training. Yes, yes. But what are you? Someone who asks others to make chocolate for her, and then lies about making them herself. I don't need any chocolate from a liar like you. That's not Battler. Harsh. Why was my lie exposed by Battler? So Lucifer is somehow connected to this? Lucifer? Despite being my furniture, you dare tattle about me to Battler? And that reminds me, those guys also lied about making the chocolate they got from Renovi by themselves. I'm both to blame. I'll beat you, punish you, torture you! And this is how the Valentine's Day of the Lying Witch went. I guess Valentine's Day wasn't a waste after all. Look forward to the White Day. See you again. Stars sure are pretty today. Raw anger on her face. And that's all. Alright, well, I think that's why Beatrice died. I think I'm going to stop there. I don't really want to read too many more tonight. My throat's kind of giving out on me. I just got off being sick. That is some nice artwork, though. But maybe tomorrow, after I've had a bit of time to rest, I might go and record the next one of these, The White Day. I know people were talking about it. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed, though. That was fun. Nice way to end off the stream. The song just ended right as I finished the chapter. But, yeah. And as for the main part of the stream as well, hope you guys enjoyed that. And I guess I will see you next time for some more Umineko. Spoilers? Spoilers. Alright, thanks for watching. Bye!